let's get started. Thank you for coming, for being on time, and for being here. This is Mindfully Constructed Class Culture, Tools to Teach Intersectionally, Multiculturally, and Cross-Culturally. As people are filing in, we're going to get started with a quick Q&A to get your mind focused on our topic and to get some ideas from you. But very quickly, I'm Sarah Trembeth. I teach in the college writing program, and this is Derek Jefferson of the library. Thanks for coming. Okay, I'll please. This is our agenda over here. If you're like me and you want to know where we're going with things, this is where you look.
Oh, it's super posted. No. So we're going to just kind of start right off the bat with our band of merry warriors here this morning. How do you identify? And we don't necessarily want to prescribe that or give you a solid definition. We want you to kind of think about that, how you identify with your own sense of self. And we'll just kind of start jotting some of these down. No one all at once. Others?
In terms of, specifically in terms of socially relevant groupings, personal identity.
Yeah, so give me one of yours.
Socially relevant groupings. Well, I won't give you just one because I can't do just one.
That's
fair enough.
That's excellent.
Yeah.
That works with what I thought about.
You've read the abstract.
Indeed. Straight, white, woman, privileged,
basic. Female privilege?
Woman, not female.
I'm sorry.
Thank you. Privileged North American. Urban.
Okay. Anyone else?
Others. I see a hand in the back.
Mother.
Mother. Librarian. Oh. We should talk. Yeah. I see another hand.
I have a disability.
Okay. Disability. Others.
Educated.
I see a hand over here.
First generation.
Others. For people that are coming in, we're talking about how we identify identities. I see a hand.
Immigrant.
Queer.
And androgynous.
Other hands.
Family and ancestry.
Okay. May I ask you a specific question?
Sure. European, Middle Eastern.
European, Middle Eastern.
Others? See hand.
Body language.
Body language? Could you be more specific? How does...
How do you express with your movements, your social distance, when you talk?
Okay.
Yeah, that can certainly be different. Okay. See another hand?
I was just going to say, I identify as an immigrant, but only when I'm here.
Right.
The best, some of them, I'm not all the time, but
others.
Ally.
Ally. Okay, so thinking about all these identities that we've shared about either yourself or your colleagues here in this room, how does that inform your teaching?
A little more
difficult. Meg?
In examples I use,
sure.
I try and hit more than one. Or try and not use myself as the example, which is the easiest thing to do.
Right.
Right, but try and go beyond what I identify with.
Others? I see a hand in the back.
Use of language.
Use of language?
Can you be more specific?
In terms of?
Choice of.
Word choice.
Word choice, phraseology.
Okay.
Notions of idiom.
Okay, notions of idiom. That's a good one. I see a hand over here.
Recognizing that because students have complex social identities, they bring a range of knowledges to the classroom, some of which isn't immediately obvious always, some of which isn't necessarily validated or valued by the dominant approach to pedagogy or the classroom experience.
Okay, so recognizing like multiple kind of social identities.
That they come with knowledge and understanding and perspective from a particular social location that is complex, that may or may not be obvious immediately.
Got that. Okay. Others, I see a hand.
As an introvert and as an introverted student, or having been an introverted student, trying to create opportunity, a variety of opportunities for students to share, so not just say a discussion with one person per floor. But also say some writing or follow-ups after discussion for people who have thought that.
So keeping an engagement.
A variety of ways to engage in, say, class participation, not just discussion.
Okay.
Think about transparency, so the ways in which my identity as white, as queer, and other parts of my identity, and the ways in which my students' identities may be underlying what's going on in the classroom and trying to make those visible. So just, I guess, transparency if we want to write down.
Thank you. Maybe one more?
Oh. I was kind of building on what the lady said here about introversion. One of the things that I try to do is to take into consideration who speaks and when they speak, because sometimes it's a function of introversion versus extroversion, but also it can also be gender related. So sort of like the intersection of those things I scan for those, and I want to make sure that I am encouraging some balance with respect to even who speaks and how they speak.
Okay,
so you're scanning yourself for making sure that you're choosing broadly.
Being inclusive.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, thank you for indulging us with our little exercise. I was asked last year to participate with the new, a book that was coming out this year, actually, about this kind of intersection, no pun intended, with autoethnography and library science. And a lot of the work that I do in my research is looking at diversity and inclusion and identity and how identity informs our instruction. So I'm going to read you a little bit of my chapter and a significant kind of interaction I had and what led me to talk about this today with the lovely Sarah. In the summer of 2014, a year after I first started as a communication librarian here at American University, a student approached me on the what we call the research desk now, with not just a question, but seemingly in a conundrum. He was a first-year student and taking, as all first-years do, a beginning writing class called College Writing. You might know that as English 101 if you're not in the lit department. This student was clearly bright, thoughtful, considerate, but he was at an impasse. This is me. So what seems to be the problem? How can I help you? I'm not really sure how to do this assignment. Have a seat, tell me a little more. It's interesting because college is different. Oh, okay, well how so? How can I help you? I think I'm just now realizing what my professor is asking us to do. So I'm from New York, upstate. I grew up on a farm. And in high school, the teachers would teach, and we would write stuff down, and then we would go over it again, and then we would cram and study and take a test or write a paper, basically just kind of telling them what they had told us. Okay, at this point, I had to stop and reflect on my own high school experience and realized, yeah, that seems on the nose. Okay, so you have this assignment. How is this different now with school and grade AU? My college professor is asking us to include ourselves in the assignment. Looking back, I don't remember the assignment verbatim, but I do know the particular professor is interested in exploring identity. What I did not know is that I was paired up with this professor as their liaison for the college writing class. So this student was actually in my class. I just hadn't met them yet because we hadn't had our grouping. So as someone who's also interested in researching identity, this pairing with me and this professor has proven fortuitous. Exploring identity as it relates to librarianship makes me curious for many reasons, but mainly because I identify as an African American and as a gay male in a profession that, at least in the United States, is roughly 87% white and 80% female. So when you're not white and you're not female and you work in a profession that is overwhelmingly so and you look as I do, what does that feel like? In many respects, I feel like I'm still figuring that out. It's a constant ebb and flow, a constant jockeying for a position and trying to find your place. And while I feel supported and respected by my colleagues and supervisors, I realize that this isn't always the case for other librarians of color, and I realize I'm very lucky in that regard. So this student, in trying to figure out his question, realized that what he wanted to do, what he had been trained to do with his public school education, was placate the teacher. Memorize, spit back, forget. He had never really been challenged, though clearly capable. He thought that what he had to do was what he had always done, and that was to make the teacher happy and giving them what they wanted. However, the professor did this one thing, this little tweak, this adjustment, a good and necessary one, if only for the fact that it unraveled the student. She asked the student to think critically. The exploration of integrating one's identity into one's writing is typical of the work the professor asked their student. As I continued working with him right there at the research desk, it became clear over the course of our reference interview that he had never really thought much about his identity. He was white, he grew up on a farm, he was from rural upstate New York, and seemed to have pretty much lived up to the expectations of what comes with that kind of life, dare I say, that kind of privilege. I want to juxtapose that with my own upbringing, the son of two Southern blacks who grew up on the banks of the Mississippi River in Memphis, Tennessee, and fled the South in 1961 or thereabouts, my father to the US Navy, my mother to a Native American reservation in Flagstaff, Arizona, where she taught school for a number of years, before eventually joining my father in San Diego. The Civil Rights Act would be passed a few years later in 1963, my brother born after that in 1969, and I born a number of years right after him in 1973 after the Paris Peace Accords were signed. We were working class folk, as best as I could tell, but I often think about things my folks must have seen in the South in the early 1960s and what their folks might have seen before them. What was life like for them in the South causing them to leave? My father retired from the military after nearly 25 years and began working for the National Park Service, him being outdoorsy and a former Boy Scout. My mother transitioned into working in the Special Education Administration, and for the most part, I was a happy, never really wanting kid who felt loved and was happy to be me. That is, until I had to think about my identity. I remember being called a nigger for the first time, and I was certainly familiar with the word, as well as the concept of blackness as it had trickled down from my parents. But I had never been called one before, and it was ugly, brutal. And it was said with such energy, such passion, that I wondered, what had I done to cause so much rancor and spite, especially at maybe 5 or 6 years old in grammar school from a classmate. In some capacity at that early age, I was almost by default being introduced to some element of a lived version of critical race theory. I knew that we were black and that we were different from white people. I learned quickly that the world I was learning to navigate wasn't a just one, and that things were different when you looked like me. I watched Good Times and the Jeffersons and saw overlaps with my own family and families like mine in the neighborhood that necessarily weren't like the Andy Griffith Show or Leave It to Beaver or Dick Van Dyke. Like many of the 70s and 80s, pop culture and media has shaped my world, and it wasn't until maybe Different Strokes or All in the Family that I saw real commentary on race through that medium. In hindsight, my parents in our conversations, some casual, some more serious, were always inflected in aspects of race that laid the groundwork for me and my brother to navigate the waters of America. America that promises any and all opportunity are available if you just work hard. You'll be rewarded with your white picket fence, your cat and dog, and your family sedan, and 2.5 kids, and heterosexual parents, and all that comes along with those ideals. That is, unless you look like us. That is, unless your skin was brown, or black, or you spoke with an accent, or you worshiped differently. Those things were attainable if you played their game, and slowly love gave you identity, what made you you, and allowed yourself to blend in, become absorbed, and part of the larger majority of the status quo. I think about this in contrast to the student I was working with that day. Was there anything as provocative or unforgettable in his upbringing? What hardships had he experienced? What was his life like as a child? Did he ever have to have a talk about how to act when pulled over by police officers? Deal with gang member bullies? Cross the street to avoid drug dealers? Code switch and talk one way in class? And back to normal with his friends once classes were over. This is me asking the student, are there any occasions where you think about your identity or how you identify yourself in your terms? The student, no, not really. And why would he, honestly? Whiteness prevails. I thought about how color-struck people of color could be after the Civil War, the concept of passing, where to be as close as white as possible and convincing each other that you were indeed white and meant privilege, as well as in some cases, survival. And even now, even today, we are still trapped not just by race, but our color, caught in between the gradations of our skin tones. From Birth of a Nation to O.J. Simpson to Donald Trump to Barack Obama, conversations on identity are all around us. So the librarian in me did my job. I shared some databases with the student, and I talked about life here in D.C. His new and current home, D.C. The history and richness of D.C. Its place in the pantheon of international cities, D.C. And not just D.C., capital city, D.C., District of Columbia, D.C., or politics Anderson Cooper on CNN, D.C., or Washington Monument in the National Mall, D.C., but D.C., D.C., Chocolate City, D.C., home to Howard University, D.C., and Duke Ellington, D.C., Meridian Hill, a.k.a. Malcolm X Park, D.C., home of the Half-Smoke, D.C., and where Frederick Douglass laid his beloved, parting aside, Afro head at night, D.C. We looked at sociological resources and initially focused on race before moving on to feminist work, and the obstacles women face in this world that we live in. We examine post-9/11 Islamophobia and the experiences of Muslims in a country where to be American is to be white, Christian, heterosexual, and middle class, never mind being born within its borders. We looked at some LGBT indexes for some insight on what it's like to be a person who identifies as such. The high incidence of suicide and murders among homelessness and homelessness amongst LGBT people. The student. So I got an email recently, and in her signature, she said that her pronouns were she and hers. What does that mean? This is me. You know, things are changing, and I think more than anything that it's just a very respectful thing to address people in the way in which they want to be addressed. I hope I left him with the idea that there's an inherent privilege that comes with a particular purview, that people can assume and live through life getting by on that privilege, but in accordance with his assignment to think about his own identity, and then of that, those who are different and how they live and what they call themselves and how they love and where they come from and what they've experienced and where they might fit in terms of class and how all of that might inform their livelihood. All of these things are fodder, and they might give him some insight for both him and his professor and the college writing class that he was participating in. My mantra was and continues to be, and I say this in each of my classes because I feel it can't be said enough, that no matter who you are, been that person at a dinner party or at some event where it seems everyone knows everyone else and we're that outsider and it feels awful to be on the outside looking in. My perspective is that no one should ever feel worthless or alone or disrespected or disregarded or cast aside or worthless. Now, I'm an African-American male sharing my experiences of my life who works hard in a country that historically and presently hasn't been very kind to African-American males. Because of our campus population, 62% female, 55% white, I often incorporate things about the lives of others into my instruction. Lives they may not know much about, lives that look like mine. Especially in the age of Ferguson and Baltimore and Black Lives Matter, when police officers seem to have collectively declared open season on men who look like me, who have shifted their gaze and actions from guardians of the peace, people seen as protectors by some, to a more problematic warrior point of view, where they literally shoot first and ask questions later. I posit that the world we live in is an ugly world and an unjust world and an unfair world, but this is our world. I'm constantly reminded by my very politically active and interested in social justice students that this is real life, not just a news clip or a tweet or a BuzzFeed post. There have been times, and I've shared this with my classes, where I hope at the end of the day that I make it home safe and sound, because nothing, even the promise of returning home from a day of work as an assistant librarian here at AU is guaranteed. In looking at the lack of diversity and inclusion in librarianship, it seems to be an extension of where we are in the world on this issue. I know that time is an issue, so I'm going to kind of hightail it through. So the student that I mentioned at the beginning, the one who approached me at the desk, who never really thought about his identity and how it informed his life, I really only had that one interaction with him that semester. I saw him another time when I taught the follow-up class the second semester with his college writing professor, and I don't think I really thought any more of it. I was glad to see that he hadn't dropped out and he was still giving it the old college try. So I saw him the next semester, matriculated in that second section of college writing, and it was before the class started. I had noticed that he was kind of running around and kind of jogging around with his friends. He had this glow about him, his eyes smiled, he was jovial and witty, and talking with his classmates in the moments before class and my instruction started, was that he had a semester of college under his belt, had he figured out life and the craziness that is Washington, D.C., learned how to manage his time and juggle his responsibilities, who's to say. He reached into his bag, he pulled out his laptop, the same laptop that he had before, except this time it was adorned with a rainbow flag and a blue and white equal sign. And he was talking to his friends about his boyfriend and where they were going to go for spring break. Thank you.
Having to negotiate boundaries where there is race and separatism, because sometimes my community was welcoming and sometimes it was very hostile. And because sometimes I can understand the immigrants that lived in our house who are lifelong friends at this point, and sometimes I couldn't. Sometimes I had to, somebody mentioned body space. Sometimes people stood closer to me when I was, that I was comfortable with, and sometimes they were distant. And so I've always had to negotiate this. And then when I went to college, I studied Black literature, which was great, right? It's a very convicting body of literature, though. And so when you bring it into the classroom, you come up where all of history bubbles up into the present, right? It's one thing to say, oh, well, I studied Black literature for 6 years. It's my body of work. But when you bring it into a classroom of African Americans, that's one thing. Everybody's empowered by it for the most part. When you bring it into a multicultural classroom, now everybody's history bubbles up, right? So when, especially when I taught in rural, in suburban Virginia at a mixed race school, I had people who were descended from slave owners. I had people who were from other countries who didn't have the same race dynamics in here. And so in order to be effective as a teacher, I have had to constantly go back and revise what I'm doing. And I feel, fingers crossed, like I've got a good pedagogy based on self-examination, trial and error, and consulting with my colleagues. That what I realized, the more that I work here, is that so many of my colleagues are already doing this. So many of my colleagues are already willing to fall on their faces and get back up again to meet hostility and confusion with the kind of energy that good teaching does when it transforms it into something educational. They're willing to self-assess that I've just, the past couple years, been pulling it together and representing it. And so what I have to offer here today, I hope, is just a few tools for your toolkit, okay? What I mean is, I don't think that this is the kind of work that people do that we can say, okay, well, here's how you do it. Right, go ahead, get your degree in it, and then go do it. I think that when you teach well, multiculturally, and cross-racially, and intersectionally, you have at your disposal a whole bunch of stuff that enables you to meet potential conflict in the moment. But more so, you're mindful about how you plan your classes, right? That you build it into the fiber of your classes. So that's what I'm gonna focus on for the next 20 minutes or so. quickly though, I just want to give you a few reality checks. First of all, recent data, empirical data from our Office of Campus Life says that the overwhelming majority of our students come from monocultural communities. And so coming here is their first prolonged exposure to people different than themselves. Another reality check. Recent empirical data from student success and retention in the Office of the Vice Provost for Undergraduate Studies says that 26% of Black freshmen, quote, do not feel at home here. They don't feel welcomed here. The question was, do you feel welcomed here? Do you feel like you belong here? And 26% of self-identifying African Americans said that they do not. Students also are reporting that they are frustrated with the microaggressions that they experience in the classroom, that they see their teachers as sort of okay at negotiate them and sort of not okay, and we know what the media picked up. Okay. Scholar James Lowen, who wrote the famous book Lies My Teacher Told Me, recently posted something that says that his new research shows that a lot of teachers avoid conversation in the classrooms about race because they're afraid of conflict. My anecdotal experience in my own department bears that out. That seems to be true among my colleagues, that people don't want to, they're walking on eggshells, they feel like it's not their job, they don't want to get into it, they don't know how to do it. And what I would say is that we do better when we choose how we're going to handle it. That's the mindful part. Okay? I had students at another university tell me that's our baggage. Race is not a big deal to them. It's something that we're bringing into their reality, that they're perfectly willing and capable to discuss it. And I have held that with me for several semesters as I developed this pedagogy. Okay. Okay, so kudos for what we're doing well. Campus-wide, there are numerous initiatives that I'm sure you're all aware of, where conversations are being had, dialogues are being had, initiatives are being offered. The Office of Diversity and Inclusion is doing outstanding work facilitating these, as is the administration, all the way up to the top. In my own department, we're having conversations. Sometimes they're smooth and easy, and sometimes they're contentious and difficult, but they're being had, right? And what I realize every time I'm part of one is that my colleagues are already doing this well and have something to offer. And so when we talk about it, we learn what each other is doing and we do better. That's what I, you know, something I come to this conversation with is that not talking about it is the problem, which is why I think Derek's work is so incredibly important. Okay? So if I could bring your attention to four of the tools I'd like to offer you from my own toolkit, the things that I draw on frequently. They're right here, and you might want to take notes on them. If you want me to send you anything that I present, you can write down your email address, and I'll send it to you. These are the most important things to me when I'm trying to teach well multiculturally. The first thing is that I centralize critical thinking. One thing that I think I could say without fear of being refuted is that racism and all the isms are inherently illogical, right? So that works on our side, assuming that everybody in here wants a more just society, right? But the other thing that's true is that they're deeply ingrained and they're emotional, right? When you centralize critical thinking, right, when you have a model, you have a sort of a step away from yourself, and the student has a step away from themselves, so that you can point to something and say, well, let's take a look at this and think more critically about it. It takes away the fear because we don't have to worry about getting in conflict, and it helps me personally stay emotionally safe. You know, I've been wounded in my classrooms when my students express racism because my teaching style is one that's very intimate. It's very dependent on my relationship with them. That's how I motivate them to turn in papers. Like, you know, like you like me, so turn in the paper. But then when they say terrible things, I'm hurt, right? Or when they hear the body of work that I'm expert in, right, that black literature which is convicted, they may be hurt. And so they act out of a reaction. When I centralize critical thinking as a model, I'm able to have dialogues that are much more effective and that keep us each in our emotionally safe zone. This is one that I use constantly. When I named it, I took the scholar's name off of it, so I'm sorry I don't remember his name off the top of my head. But I will send it to you if you'd like it. It's a very simple tool that shows affective, literal, and critical comprehension of things. And I introduced, when I introduce it, almost the first day of class, I refer to it constantly throughout the semester. And let me tell you how I use it. This was actually developed to help people read more critically. So when students are reading on sort of a surfacey, basic level, this scholar came up with a way of helping them read more critically. And I use it that way, but it really helps me in uncomfortable racial situations. So affective reading and comprehension is nothing but an emotional reaction, right? So it's when your students read a book and they're like, I hate this, or I love this, or I hate her. That's what they want to talk about the first time they read because they're 18, right? That's where they respond. Literal understanding, you're getting slightly more complex. You might be asking questions about the history of the person writing it or some of the things that inform the book. Critical thinking is based on questioning, really, right? Sometimes when you're critically reading, you are asking questions, you're examining biases, you're examining attitudes, and it's a much higher level of thinking. So let me tell you how I use this as a person who strives to teach well cross-culturally. When I get things that I consider racist, right, that I consider short-sighted, I almost never, with maybe three exceptions in my entire career, I've been teaching for 20 years, I almost never say, this is racist. And I would never say you are racist, right? I don't engage, with very, very few exceptions, students in that kind of dialogue. That's a real danger zone for a teacher to get into. Students, if you say that, students feel that they're being molded as humans instead of educated. They also feel that you're going to have a prejudice against them when you grade. Okay, so what I always do, I have so many of these around my world, I whip it out, and I say, it sounds to me like you're responding affectively. Do you remember the triangle? It sounds to me like you're responding affectively. What could you learn? Remember, my goal as a writing teacher is to bring you around to the critical thinking, right? So what could you learn? What literal information could you bring to the situation? So now you're asking questions about people's backgrounds, you're asking about histories, you're delving deeper. What questions could you raise about biases? Okay, I'll send this to you if you want. I'll have the author's name. This is a tool that I go back to over and over again. The next one that I use is work that makes things more complex. I'm not so sure complexify is a word, but I use it regularly. This is one that I like the best. It's by Stuart Green and April Ladinsky. And I introduced this early in the semester, too. One of the things that I say is that scholars complexify things, right? That true scholarship is complex. That students, especially when we get them, they want to be right, right? All of our students are bright, right? And they're used to getting rewarded by grades for being right about something, right? As Derek said, presenting it back. But what I say is, okay, you're in college now. True scholarship makes things complex. It breaks things down into many components. It raises many questions that are difficult to sit with, that are uncomfortable, right? So in order to be scholarly, right, it's not discounting everything they learned from high school and saying, well, that was garbage, let's do this better. It's saying, in order to do it at the higher level, you have to complexify things. So I teach a hip-hop poetics class, one of my classes, and I'm constantly hearing stereotypes about black men that really drive me bananas, right? And it's difficult for me as a black woman to say, you know, to not just be like, oh, I hate this paper, like, this is so racist. You know, but what I've learned how to do is to use their language. They also have a section on empathy, that scholarship is it shows empathy. And so part of being a good scholar is to understand the other's perspective. So instead of me grading that paper and say, this is so racist, like, how do you even know this about black men? This is whatever, you know? I say, how can you bring more empathy into this? What might be their perspective? What's the other side of this? Remember Green and Ladinsky, how they talked about making things more complex? What are the other ideas that you're not considering? Do you hear the difference between the language? And so because most of us aren't going to do the first thing, we're not going to say, you're such a racist, F. What we do is we avoid the topic, right? So we just read quickly and keep it moving. But what I would say is, and I can send you this, there are scholars out there looking at things with a critical eye that can help us have language to help our students move forward as scholars. It takes us a little bit away from the conversation about race per se into the conversation about how to be more critical thinkers. Let's see. This is very high tech how I've done this. One of the things that my department uses a lot is the work of Chimamanda Adichie. And so if you're familiar with her work, she has a TED talk that something like 42 million people have watched or something. So when I get those racist narratives, actually before I even get them, I show her work, which is on the danger of single narratives, right? So she talks about how important it is that when people tell stories, they consider other people's stories to get a more balanced perspective, okay? So instead of saying something or feeling something like, you don't know what you're talking about, how can you even talk about that? You don't know all these other people. You show this video and you can say, okay, well, where will we find other narratives that show a more balanced perspective? And what questions come out of them? This is where my working with my librarians really helps, because they help us find those other narratives. Okay, and that brings me into the work of Linda Elder and Richard Paul, two critical thinking scholars whose work I use almost religiously. They are, I think they're the founders of the Society for Critical Thinking, and they have produced numbers of books on the topic, and I use them all the time. I present them at the beginning of the semester because their work gives me language to troubleshoot the problems that I already know I'm going to have later on. Okay, so one of them, as I just mentioned, is about the art of asking essential questions. That true scholarship doesn't land on easy answers or simple binaries, false binaries, that it raises questions. Okay, so this book, which is available in part for free online, is called The Art of Asking Essential Questions. They made a portion of it available online for free. And they've helped me learn how to develop teaching exercises that teach my students how to simply ask questions, especially where racism is concerned, right? Especially where cross-cultural narrow-mindedness is concerned. What people really have to do is learn to know what they don't know, right? And they have to learn how to ask questions, right? Do I really know that Muslims are all bad? I have to learn how to say to myself, do I really know that? And what questions can I ask? Are there various sects of Islam? How is the media portraying? And so I work into the first quarter of my semester exercises where all they're doing for homework is asking questions. So when they read for me, they don't come up with summaries a lot of the time. They don't say back what they know or what I want them to say or how I feel. They ask questions. I grade them on the quality of their questions. And I use Linda Elder and Richard Paul's work as the guideline on how to do that. They say that the quality of our thinking is given in the quality of our questions. Again, it takes it out of me telling them what to do and puts it into them thinking, because thinking critically and asking questions is the way we break down racism in our classrooms. Perhaps the biggest tool I use, let me see if I can find it. Another one of my identities is that I need glasses, but I refuse to get them, so these are dollar store glasses. Let's see. I hope you can see that. No. How do I make it bigger? Can I do this? Nope. Okay, that's okay. Do you know how to make it bigger? Okay, they have their first work. I'm walking away from the mic because now my nose is slightly rebellious. So their first work is called The Miniature Guide to Critical Thinking, and it's like a, you can see how tattered it is. It's like a Bible for me for this kind of work. And what they have to find is the problems with problematic thinking. And so they list them. Well, they say that everyone thinks, it's our nature to do so, but much of our thinking left to itself is biased, distorted, partial, and uninformed. I like how they use the word our, because it makes it everybody's problem, right? It's not like your problem, I'm smart, I'm the professor, your problem is how poorly you think, plus you're a racist. And some more stuff, right? Okay. So it's our nature to be biased, distorted, partial, uninformed, or downright prejudiced, they say. Yet the quality of our life and that of which we produce, make, or build depends precisely on the quality of our thought. Shoddy thinking is costly, both in money and the quality of life. Excellence in thought, however, must be systematically cultivated. I love this, this one tiny little page of this book, because our students strive for excellence. They would not be here if they didn't, right? And so now you're making this a goal for people who are excellent. But what's important about how they break down excellent thought or the problems with unexcellent thought, these are the last two. Egocentrism and sociocentrism, okay? They say, this is one of six or seven of them, critical thinking entails effective communication and problem-solving abilities and a commitment to overcoming our native egocentrism and sociocentrism. So we define this early in the semester. My students have this. And so when I see problematic thinking that is biased and prejudiced and distorted, I don't talk to them about it as Sarah. Right? That would put me in a place of being wounded, possibly, being hurtful, possibly, And so I pull this out and I say, okay, so how can we take this a little bit more outside of yourself? Remember, Elder and Paul say, right, excellence in thinking requires us to be, whatever. Okay, I can put it on my rubrics if I want. If I'm noticing a problematic pattern or if I'm anticipating it, I could put it on my rubrics, and I have, especially in a hip-hop class, right? So egocentrism is too focused on self, and sociocentrism is too focused on one's group or culture. So I can say, how can you shift your focus to include other people's perspectives? It is such a different conversation than, oh, this is racist, I hate it, I'm avoiding it, or you're a racist, okay? Okay. The next thing I'd like to bring to your attention is how important it is to do what I call focusing on meta-dialogue. To me, I might have made that up too, I'm not sure. But to me, there's already a conversation going on in the United States about how history is taught. I think Derek brought that out a little bit. And so when I teach, because I also teach literature, I teach books, history comes into it a lot. So if I'm simply saying, I taught another university, I taught a literature survey. And my first unit had to do with the founding of the country. There was Native American literature in it. There were slave narratives in it, and there were the so-called founding fathers and their stuff. And so all of our issues were like right there. Mm-hmm. So if I was me and I was saying, well, you know, Thomas Jefferson held slaves and George Washington had slaves, so this is garbage and we don't do them anymore, and we just read slave narratives and that tells the real deal. Then I taught that in Virginia, so then I have a lot of people who are upset with me and who turn off as learners, right? What I'm finding, when I was in school, I learned how African-American students tune out in classrooms because they weren't represented in the teaching material. What I'm seeing is that white students tune out when I get too black, right? When my material is too convicting, right? And so one of the things I do is I introduce the dialogue about history and narratives as a dialogue. It puts us all on the same side. Let me tell you what I mean. So if I say to my class, okay, so we're about to look at these five pieces of work. They all come from different perspectives. And we're engaging in, writing scholars talk about entering the conversation. We're about to enter the conversation about how history should be taught, how literature should be taught, how to select text materials. So as we read these things, I want you to be thinking about the editor's choices, my choices as a teacher. Right? How these things interact with each other. And what I found when I taught that class in Virginia is that doing it that way made everybody on the same side and took everybody out of their feelings. Because people were raw in that classroom for a little while when I started with the Thomas Jefferson piece. and so doing it that way made them, it gave them a chance to step a degree outside of the thing, right? But I know I had people who came from the other side of the plantation system in that classroom, right? I know that. And so everybody was able just simply to talk about the dialogue as a dialogue. It was a safe zone emotionally, but it was also effective educationally. They were thinking on a higher level critically. And so when things get sticky sometimes, or when I've got material that I know is going to start stuff in class, that's where I step back. Not out to my own comfort zone where I'm not talking about it, but really to a higher level of critical thinking. Okay. One of my personal shticks is something that we call the Sankofa ethic. The Sankofa ethic, it's a West African term, and it means bringing the history into the present to understand more and to move towards a better future. It's an ethic, right? And I keep it in mind all the time because it tells me that one of my jobs as a teacher is to be constantly learning. And so the material that I present, I have to understand before I present it, because when you examine something in the moment and you're not going deep enough, people can say whatever they want about it. And so that's something that constantly keeps me learning. And when I am frustrated with my colleagues or people I see around campus, it's because they're not doing this. I have to be honest about that. And so I want to bring up an incident just that was a little contentious recently. It has been noted in the press as the banana incident. And when you read the newspaper reports of the guy that threw the banana into the two black girls' rooms, I think there were two separate incidents, it was reported on the press as the banana incident, and people were taking sides as to whether the kids who did it meant it or not, right? And what I found was the people who were able to speak to that in their classroom knew the history of it. They either knew it from their own studies or they took the time to ask, which is really all I'm asking. And so, I hope you can see this. What I learned from reading Thomas Jefferson's notes on the state of Virginia back when I was in graduate school is that one of the ways that slavery was justified was by saying that Africans were like a missing link between monkeys and regular humans. And Thomas Jefferson justified slavery to a person from France asking about it by saying, well, they're more like orangutans. And so that's just a part of black literary history that's very real. It carried up through American culture in the form of minstrelsy and this constant portrayal as African Americans as monkey-like. And so these cartoons from this website show from the 1800s all the way up through 1941. Anybody paying attention to what white supremacists are up to realize that the Obamas have had that projected on them a lot. And that even as recently as like the past 5 years, European sports fans who are white supremacists, you know, have taken to throwing bananas at athletes who are African, of African ancestry. I was about to say African American, but it's European, it's Brazilian, it's everywhere. And so somebody at our university thought that would be funny, right, to do that. What I heard some of my colleagues say that concerned me was like, well, they didn't mean it, they didn't understand it, right? Because that's what we want to believe. We don't want to believe that our students, who to some degree or other we love, right, or we respect, right, or we want to see them do well, would do something like that. It's not who we think of ourselves as a university, right? But to simply say, well, they didn't mean it, is to take a position. It's to take an uninformed position that's alienating to your students and to your colleagues who are of color, or your colleagues who know, right? And so even for us, we have to indulge in the asking of questions. Well, do I really know what the kids meant? What's the history behind this? Why are my colleagues of color so sure that they knew what they were doing? At the very least, we know it's happening all over the world, right? So, So I keep the Sankofa ethic in mind because it reminds me how incredibly important it is to go back into the history. When I teach the hip-hop class, I teach from a very Bronx perspective of where how dance evolved. But I had a guest speaker come in and tell me about the lesbian and gay contribution to West Coast dance styles that I knew nothing about. And right there in that classroom, I changed my syllabus for next semester because I realized I had been excluding another marginalized community's work from my teaching. And so we have to go back. We have to be willing to go back. Okay? The last thing, and I'm running out of time, is that we have to be willing to explore majoritarian narratives in a new way. This is just coming from me personally. I don't have any tiny graphics to support it. One of the things that I've encountered doing this work as an educator is that my body of work is considered racial, right, because it's black, right? That I went to Howard University. I studied at the undergraduate level. I studied black literature. I did my graduate work in it. And because it's black, and because black writers talk about race, my work is considered racial, right? Latino work is considered racial, right? Asian work is considered racial. But white work is often seen as neutral. But the students of color in your classroom read between the lines automatically, and they respond to things that you may or may not see. If it's a majoritarian narrative, especially if it's classic or if it's been taught for a long time, and that's your origin, you have to work extra hard to ask yourselves, what will my students of color be seeing in this? Right? we read a book in our department that had humanitarian aid worker going around and doing certain things, and the students who were of color reacted to it completely different than students who were white, you know. And so to anticipate that is to ask questions, right? I don't actually have that experience, so I don't know how people do that, but I do know that some people do it very well and some people do it poorly. So in my department, I'm talking to the people who do it well, to my white colleagues who do it well, to ask them what they do. Right, I have a colleague, Teddy Helfers, who teaches students of color very effectively. I worked with him this summer at the STEP program, and I asked him, you know, coming from a white neighborhood in Missouri, right, how do you do this well? One of the things that he said is that he educates himself. He reads narratives from people outside of his own community, so he's training himself to question. Okay, I'm sorry, I completely flew through that and I got the 5-minute warning. And so I would like to ask you, one more thing. In your syllabus, this is a bonus one, in your syllabus, make sure you include guidelines for respectful dialogue. Because if you're going to do this, if you're stepping outside of a comfort zone to say, we're going to talk about these things, you might get people, you know, angry and acting up a little bit, right? But when you have something to point to, right, the CTL has a civil dialogue, a new document on how to conduct civil dialogue in, you know, in your classroom. You can refer to it, right? You don't want to say, this is not how we talk. It becomes personal. The student feels persecuted, like, because they have a conservative viewpoint, you're going to grade them, whatever. But if you have something that's a standard already at hand and already in your syllabus, you can point to that and say, let's see how we can work towards these standards of this civil dialogue. Okay, put it in your syllabus. Thank you for paying attention. Could you please fill out your evaluation form and feel free to ask questions in the next few minutes? Thank you, Derek.
Thank you, Sarah.
<CCO. Thank> you.